Okay, so this is the standard trick we always use in probability, right? If we don't know the underlying distribution, we go with the samples of this distribution and use that to have some empirical estimates of the quantity that we are trying to optimize. Okay, so empirical estimate of the quantity we are trying to estimate. Here, this is the quantity. If I know, I could go into this optimization, right? But I don't know this, so I want to get the empirical estimate of this using my data samples. So the standard thing here is to do empirical So now, what will be a good empirical estimate of this quantity from the data samples I have? One thing is, what I can do is, I can say my LSH. So S is the training data that I have been given. I can use this. And I am going to write an empirical estimate for this as 1 upon m into okay, let us understand what is this doing. I have S is given to me, S is given to me. What I am doing is, and I am trying to compute this quantity for my hypothesis H. So, I will just see on how many points I agree with the value yi. Yi is the label, right? So this quantity is just give me this. So this is the set. So the value within this braces is going to give me a set of all the points, the data points on which my hypothesis H does not agree, right? So yi is the corresponding label of xi. I am just counting how many points my H does not make a correct prediction, and now I am dividing it by m. Okay, so what is this size? So I am taking the cardinality here. That means the numerator will tell me the number of points where my hypothesis H has made incorrect predictions, and I am dividing it by m. So what is this quantity is telling? The fraction of the points on which my hypothesis has made a wrong prediction. Okay, so next. So henceforth, what I will do is, this x I, so x 1 y 1, these are actually one sample, right? But instead of write, I am just going to write them as capital X and y. That means this x is a random variable, y is also a random variable, but this y depends on x through the function f. So this x is a random variable which is drawn from my distribution D. Once I know this, this y is simply the function f of that point x. So these are my points, like I have, this is my random variable, and these are just like realizations of this. Okay. Now suppose this is a particular realization, but let's say, let me say that my I could have x1, y1, x2, y2, xm, y. this could be all of them drawn from the same distribution, right? So this x I y I coming from the same environment. So these are just m points drawn from the same environment. Now if I say that these points are drawn independently and anyway they are identically distributed, as m goes to infinity, what this quantity is equal to? Yes. So is this quantity is going to be equal to this, the probability of the disagreement? Why is that? Which what did you apply to conclude this? So if this xi pairs are IIDs, independent identically distributed, I can apply my Laws of number says that this has to be equal to this, right? But it's just that m is not infinity here, m is some finite number. That's why we are going to call it empirical risk. And now this quantity here, we are going to use it as a proxy for this quantity. And now I am going to minimize this over h. Okay, that's why we are going to call this method as empirical risk minimization. Now, so what I will do is I will do this empirical. So this is in general, popularly just we are going to call it as ERM. ERM technique. What it is going to do is as minimize for h belongs to h, now do. I am trying to, my goal was to minimize this, but it just that I do not know this. But what I did is I found a proxy for it based on the quantities I know and then trying to minimize this quantity. Okay. Next, the question is, fine, if you do like this, whatever this quantity is, the minimum value of this, if you do this, how far these two quantities are away from? Are they very close to each other or they will be very far from each other? Your goal was to minimize this, right? But you ended up minimizing this. Then you would like to ask the question, whatever I get from doing this, how far this value is going to be from this value? Okay. And whatever the hypothesis I get from this, let me call this as argmax of this. The hypothesis I am going to get, I am going to call it as ERM S and this hypothesis. So notice that it depends on the training set you got and over the hypothesis class you are trying to find your hypothesis. Okay. So this is one training set that I have given to you from which you got your empirical risk minimization hypothesis. If I change this S, can your empirical risk minimization hypothesis can change? It can potentially change, right? Because these quantities have been explicitly used. All these data points have been used coming from set S. If you are going to set S, it is going to change. Okay. Or maybe like I will, instead of this, I will also going to use it as HS. Simply this quantity, this empirical risk minimization. So subscript S denotes, makes it explicit that this hypothesis depends on your training data. Okay. So now your training data, whatever that is given to you, it is generated from this particular distribution D, right? Every time you are going to generate this data, you may end up with different set of data points. Okay. Because of this, this set S itself is a random quantity. Okay. And because of this, this H of S can be also random, right? It depends on the data set you have used to generate to learn this hypothesis. So, yes, this H of S is a random quantity, it depends on the data set. But as I said, what kind of guarantee we can give about the hypothesis we got by doing this empirical risk minimization with respect to whatever the best one. Okay. So, there is, when we do all these things, the hypothesis class matters. If you are going to change hypothesis class, things can also change. What we are going to now, just to understand what we wanted to see, like the difference between this minimum and this minimum, let us focus on the case where we have only hypothesis class which has only finitely many elements in this. Okay, before that, how many of you know what is overfitting? So, what happens in overfitting? No, just tell me what happens on the training data. So, what will be this quantity? Let us say if you have a very low, if you have overfit, what is this quantity for some hypothesis? You can always find a hypothesis which will ensure that on your data points it exactly does the correct job. If it does the correctly job, this quantity is going to be 0, right? It may do a very good on the training one, but when I look at the actually the test error here, where the points are not just these points, right, the data points, they could be also coming from other parts, it may not do well. So, there are some things like the how big is your hypothesis class and all, they are going to affect your overfitting issues. So, for that, like that is not of our interest, so we will not go more into that, but what we are going to assume is this hypothesis class is finite size. That is, the cardinality of this set is finite. Okay. So, if this hypothesis has like infinitely many components in this, right, you will always come up with the hypothesis class which will overfit and make this loss 0, right. And in that case, you will your empirical risk minimization always end up showing you a hypothesis class which is like a overfit on the data. So, when you have only finitely you restrict your hypothesis class, that kind of overfitting you may avoid. So, let us for time being assume that this hypothesis class is has a finite many elements in this. Okay. Now, let us say whatever hypothesis you got from your training data, I want to now measure its performance. So, what I when I will then how I am going to do this? So, here the H that has been you have found out is your H of S based on your training data, right. Now, you want to see what is its success. So, what you will do is then whatever H of S you have got, now I want to I am interested in this quantity, this is. So, you have done this empirical risk minimization using data set and you have come up with this hypothesis H of S. Now, I want to measure its performance. Now, I would say your empirical risk minimization has given you a good hypothesis if I can show that this quantity is small, right. Or like if this quantity is 0, that is the best, maybe like, but I want to, can I claim that this quantity is going to be small. So, what are the things that governs how good your hypothesis H of S? So, what do you think you will have come up with a better hypothesis H of S that will make this quantity smaller? when you think what are the things in your setup that are going to affect how good my hypothesis H of S. So I am assuming that this data points are generated in an IID fashion, right? So instead of giving, let's take m equals to 10, let's say I just give you 10 points and then using those 10 points you come with your empirical risk minimizer, let's call that as HS1 there, and later I give you 100 points, I added 10 more, 90 more points to your 10 points, you have 100 points, and using this 100 points you come up with is another HS2. What do you think, HS1 will be better or HS2 will be better? Why? So when you have larger, yeah, so you will be approximating this function more accurately, and maybe because of that you will end up with this. So naturally M has a role to play here, right? How many data points you have on what, how good this H of S is going to be. So notice that, like, there is also, I said this could have M points, but each of the points here itself could be generated independently, right? So for time being, let's say that, let's take a two-dimensional case. Let's say my x-axis denotes humidity levels, okay, and my y-axis denotes, so instead of this, let me call it x1 component and x2 component, denotes my humidity levels, oh sorry, temperature levels. And let's say these are the points. So these are some points I have observed. Let's say when it rains, when high humidity and high temperature, when it's going to rain? High humidity, low temperature. Okay, let's assume we are like some weather, fake weather experts. I don't know what. Let's say in this region, let's say, so in this region it's going to rain. All these points has the label that they are going to rain, and below this point these are like not going to rain. Yeah, I'm just like, this is a hypothetical case, it's not necessary there should be a nice separation like this, it could be much more complicated. And like, okay, so these are data points, but let's say this is my range of humidity, let's say humidity goes from some value 0 to maximum some value, let's call this x, so this is like x1 max. And my temperature also 0 to, let's say, some x2 max, something like this, okay. Let's say the actual way it happens is whenever, let's say in some fashion, so in this, let's say it is all going to rain, and in this it's not going to rain. This is how, let's say, the actual environment behaves. Now what you are doing is you are basically getting samples from this, right? Over the past history you are basically getting so this is rain and this is no rain. Let's say you are now collected data from the last 10 years and the last 10 years happens to be like a drought years, okay, maybe. So it means there was not enough rain in those cases. So because of that, most of the data you collected happens to be from this portion, from the last 10 years. Your data set will have data mostly coming from this portion, okay. If you are going to train on this portion of the data, do you think your the hypothesis you are going to end up will have a you will do a good performance? No, right? Because it didn't get to see the full things here, like it didn't get the full picture, so it may not be able to do. So, and also like if it, so if you just see this, what it will feel that, okay, it looks like this, in this part of the world, it's always going to be drought. Every year it is going to declare that it's going to be drought, 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 and everybody will panic. But let's say if all the data point like last 10 years happens to be again like flooding or something, and you got lot of points from this, this is also going to be bad. You are, whatever you are going to get, it is going to predict, it's going to rain, 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 and it is not going to be a good thing. So, from which portion of your distribution the data came also matters, right? Because of that, the S itself is going to matter how good or bad your hypothesis. That's why we have also subscripted this. Notice that we are saying that these points are IID generated, right? I'm saying these points are getting IID. So when I'm saying this IID generated, it's unlikely that all the points are sampled, they concentrate on one area. You get this? So maybe when I'm generating is IID, maybe possibly they will be spread more in this, and maybe they will give me a true representation of what's happening. But still, when you are generating IID with some small probability, you may still get samples only from one region of this, right? Right? It's not like even if you generate IID, you will get with high probability samples from all over the regions. I mean, probability one. It may end up with some small probability. It may happen all the data points you generated could be coming from this small region, which could be bad representation of this. Because of this, whatever I have here, this quantity here itself will be determined by the data samples I am going to see, and not only that, what is the size of that data set. You may have large samples, you could increase m to large number of points, but with some small probability, all of them might have come from a small region, small area, which could make your empirical risk minimization hypothesis really bad. Because of that, this value could be also bad. So in this case, we want to see that whatever this hypothesis we learned from this given data set S, what kind of guarantee I can give on this? So is it true that if I have this large number of points in S, that's enough to make it arbitrarily small? Need not, right? Because as I said, even you may have large number of points, but those sampled points might be coming from some raw small region, which could make this a bad representation of your space. Okay. So the kind of guarantee we are going to give, henceforth, that's why it depends. A probabilistic guarantee we are going to give, and we will only going to say that how small this is going to be. Okay. So before we give any such things, to make such results concrete, we may require some assumption. I will just tell you what I mean. We are going to assume that there exists a hypothesis in my hypothesis class such that it is going to give me zero loss on all possible realizations of my data set. So let me just make that formal. So with this assumption, we are going to call it as okay. So we'll assume that there exists a hypothesis class H star in my hypothesis class H such that whatever this quantity I have, whatever the prediction error I'm going to get, what I have written as is that so what does this imply? We are basically saying that S star equals to f with probability 1. Okay. So, it may happen that on some points it may, this H star may not assign the same level of f, but those number of points have 0 mass. So, let us say this assumption holds. Okay. Okay, if let us say if this assumption holds, is it true that if I compute this quantity for any s on H star, what will this value be? That will be also 0, right? So this basically means that you take any data samples, I will have an H that will have a 0 loss. Okay. Now, once I assume that there exists such a H star which is belonging to my hypothesis class, if I go and do this empirical minimization, whatever that minimizes this value, so we know that at least there is one H star here that is going to make this quantity 0, right? Whatever HS we are going to have, that is going to have this quantity to be 0, and there could be more than one, but what we are interested is the one which minimizes this. Okay. So, let us assume this. This can be all easily realized, but for time being, let us say that my hypothesis class is expressive enough such that it captures the true labeling phenomena. That means the true label, it can do as good job as a true labeler. That is, it can be as good as a the true labeling function f. That's why we are saying. So if this happens, then we have the following result. So you have to get used to such statements, now onwards. So let's try to understand what is this result saying. Okay. It says that, let's say H be a hypothetical class where H is finite and a delta is given to you and epsilon also given to you. Then if you are going to choose your m, m here is going to denote the number of data points to be larger than this. And if you are going to give me data points which are generated IID and it has at least this m number of points in it, then whatever this error, whatever the hypothesis class I am going to learn by empirical risk minimization, it is guaranteed to have a loss which is smaller than epsilon. And that is going to happen with probability 1 minus delta. As I said, I cannot give a deterministic guarantee on this, because even though I can give a lot of samples, the samples may come from some bad region. So I have to, I can make this guarantee probabilistic, I can only give probabilistic guarantee. Now let's try to understand how to interpret this result. I have, let's say you are in a company, you have been told to find, give me a hypothesis whose value is going to, whose true value, this quantity is going to be less than epsilon with probability 1 minus delta. So let's say your boss has given this parameter to you. We can't guarantee anything in world with probability 1, right? In being realistically, we can guarantee something to happen with some probability. Maybe that probability is very high, like me being alive tomorrow, maybe very high, but it is still probabilistic, right? There is always some, maybe there is also some case that probability that sun may not rise tomorrow is not with probability 0. It may not rise some with some positive probability. So we have to give similar, like let's say I'm also asking the same thing, keeping that in mind, I'll ask, okay, give me this guarantee with this probability. And my guarantee has been specified by two things. I want loss to be not more than epsilon, it should be less than epsilon, and this should happen with this probability 1 minus delta. Yeah, this delta. Yeah, we will be careful with delta and 8. So these are the parameters that have been given to you. If anybody asks you to guarantee anything, you also can't give him that guarantee, right? You will be also demanding. You are going to tell, see, okay, I will guarantee you this, but you give me this many data points, m number of data points. And how is this m determined? Like this. If you are asking for epsilon accuracy, epsilon guarantee and with delta accuracy, I want you to give me this many samples, then I will guarantee you that whatever the hypothesis I am going to give, that will have a loss which is less than epsilon. Okay. So if somebody asks you, get me this job done in 1 hour or something, then you will ask, okay, give me 10 GPUs, 10 servers, I will get it done in 1 hour. So like this, somebody is asking you to give you this guarantee, then we are going to say, if you give me this many data points, then you will be guaranteed your guarantee. Okay. So you see this, so this is a kind of, wanted to go through quickly this supervised setting, like all of you who have done this course in machine learning, when you touch upon this learning theory, this is what you are going to do there, right? So this is kind of, this is touching upon the sample complexity. If you want to learn something with some guarantee, you need certain number of data samples. Okay, so this kind of results lead to sample complexity result. Now, but this is not of our interest, right? This is just like a precursor. What we are interested is, I don't have a priori access to this m data points that are given. Like in this case, you have already been given m data points. You train on this and try to apply it on a new point, and you are trying to guarantee that how well you are going to perform on the new data point, right? And you have been guaranteeing such things. Now I am going to say, I don't have luxury of collecting all this data, right? Suppose, let's say in the weather case, right, like somebody was collecting data for the last 50 years and they give it to you and he is asking you to predict. Even that we don't do well, right? Like we have so much of historical data, but our weather forecasts are always wrong. But what, so that is one case, fine. But what it may be happen, right? Like what happens if you don't have any such information at all, but you want to make a good prediction right from day one? How you are going to go about it? Fine, on day one you have nothing, you can't do anything. But after doing something on day one, you have some information for day two, right? Can you think of doing something better than what you did on day one? And you do something on day two. Now, for the day three, you have information about day one and day two. Can you use this to do something better than in day three than what you did in day one and day two? And as information gets to you, can you quickly try to do what's the best you could have done? So that is where we were going to get into this online machine learning here. So in this case, we have already bunch of data. We want to train and guarantee what we are going to do from the whatever we learned from the past. But in my online setting, I don't have this luxury. But we are going to be ambitious and we are going to set our goal as I want to do quickly as soon as possible. And you will also see that we are going to set our goal as what we are doing, is it how good it is compared to the case when I knew everything. Like I am the oracle, if I am the oracle of like nature myself, so when I say nature, it is like about the data generating process. If I knew everything, I know what is the best I could have done, right? Now I am going to always compare myself to that. Like I don't know anything, I am started getting this incremental observations, using that how quickly I am going to do as if I knew everything. If you could do it as if you knew everything, that means basically you have learnt. And now the question is how to set up this and how to characterize all these things. So that is what we are going to start looking at from the next class, and there we are going to see various settings. Okay, so let's stop here.